Okay. So, Girls at Dhabas started out as a hashtag on social media about public space and gender. And basically, what we want to talk about is that women are hardly seen out in on the streets of Karachi, maybe loitering or just being out for leisure. So, like just to illustrate, I went to the bank yesterday, and I felt like I was literally the only woman there, and that is that's a common thing that you will see on the streets as well. That there is no that there are hardly be women walking out on the streets for leisure, and it's like, and we want to change that. We want to talk about, we want to say that, and we shouldn't have to go to expensive cafes to have a cup of tea or to be you know, in a space which people deem safe for us, because if we are out, public space should by definition be safe for everyone. So that's what we are working for.
Right. So you know, the kind of argument jo di jati hai ke, you know, girls shouldn't be out alone at night, and that's something we hear a lot growing up here from our parents. I think after you hit puberty, you're kind of, there are different rules for boys and different rules for girls. Ke agar ladki ko bahar jana bhi hai, you have to go out, you have to be chaperoned by somebody, or you have to, you know, have your brother take you somewhere, or your driver, especially in upper class families. So what we end up doing is we basically make this argument ke agar ladki ko safe rakhna hai, then she must be protected, right? So out of protection, we start to control women's bodies. And what happens is ke hum aur dabbe mein band, we start putting ourselves in boxes. So you're in the home box, and then you sit in the car box or a bus box, and then you're in the office box or your friend's house box or a coffee shop box. Compare that to the way you see men interacting with the city, right? The fact that if there's a cabin or coca tapri, jo aap log kehte hain, cigarette ki dukaan, you know, you will see men lounging there or sitting on a sidewalk. And in Pakistan, in the urban spaces, we see a lot of dhabas, which are essentially tapris, but they usually have an extended area where you can sit, and there are these plastic chairs that we're sitting on right now. So we're at one of the dhabas that I come to a lot, and there's a big tree there, and it's quieter from the rest of the city. And you don't really see women here, so this is a strange sight for even the men here to see, not just one, but four women. But the way we think about it is, the more we step out and the more we start getting comfortable in these spaces, not just for us does it get a normalized thing, but also for the men in these spaces and the other people in these spaces. So an interesting anecdote is, you know, there's one dhaba in my neighborhood where I started going a lot, and then I started going there alone. And then after a while, when I hadn't been there for a week, I got there and the dhaba wala was like, oh, Baji, you know where you were. So you start to, instead of seeing spaces as sites of fear, you start to see them as sources of, you know, comfort or getting out of whatever routine of the day that you're in.
Yeah.
Or even just like sitting and, you know, you just want some, you want a time out for no reason at all, and you just want to lounge around in the city, you should be able to do that. Typically in Karachi, when I have been out alone at night walking, I have been mistaken for a sex worker. So I have men come up to me and ask me, you know, how much, kitne ki hai, and things like that. Because they assume that if you are out alone at night without a man with you, then there must be, you know, you must be there for business. You can't just be there for leisure or pleasure. And that's the sort of thing we're trying to attack and say, it doesn't have to be like that. Women also, we can, and we are building these intimate relationships with the city and with the spaces of the city. We are interacting with our different landscapes, you know, and the idea of pleasure, I think, plays a very big role in this. And exactly. Already aurton ko kaha jata hai na ke, don't own your pleasure, but these everyday things are part of almost like survival, I think, you know, the ability to just say, hey, I'm going out for a walk, and instead of your mother saying, kya bolengi ammi,
बोलिंग किस लिए, किसके साथ जा रही हो,
किसके साथ जा रही हो,
किस लिए
जा रही हो, क्यों जा रही हो, कब आओगी, इंस्टेड ऑफ हर डूइंग दैट, हर जस्ट बीइंग लाइक ओके कूल सी यू.
I mean, even through this initiative, when I joined, I have decided that after work I'll go to a park and read, because that is, I started noticing how much of my day is just so planned out. You get up in the morning, you get in the car with your driver who drops you to work, and he has to pick you up at 6. Like, after 6, my time is not mine to do with as I please, because you have to be home, ghar pahunchna hai, ye karna hai, wo karna hai. And I'm like, no, I get off, I get into a rickshaw, go to a park, I read, I use that time, my, I mean, like he says, owning my pleasure. Because I want to, like, when I was abroad, I was able to do these things, and I want to keep doing that in Karachi as well, because then I will constantly keep complaining that Western societies let us do this and we can't do that here. So we need to create that space, and this is what personally I started doing, and I think it has changed my relationship with the city. I don't fear things anymore. I'll go and the more I've noticed, like, people are normalizing themselves to the situation as well, as in a woman reading on her, like, even on an e-reader, clearly it shows class and privilege, but they don't come and bother anymore. They won't say anything.
Because you become a part of the landscape. Exactly. You become a common sight, and so you're accepted and welcomed in that space. So what Girls at Dhabas is basically grounded in is really the idea of storytelling and sharing our experiences. Because the way it started was 2 years ago, just posting a photograph of ourselves at a dhaba. And, you know, just to kind of see how people in our circle would react. Shurume, it was not a public page, a public initiative. It was just on our personal timelines, a bunch of us started uploading photos of ourselves in public spaces. And these conversations started within the group of girls and our networks on social media. Oh, this is interesting. Oh, or, you know, all kinds of responses from, oh, I've thought about this too as a woman. Or, oh, I've always wanted to go to a dhaba. Can we go together? Or even like, oh, wait, I've done this and this is how it feels like. So we realized that, okay, there's space for this conversation to maybe grow into something, because it sounds like it's a much needed conversation, and it's linked to, you know, log aksar hame kehte hain ke, what does this have to do with feminism? And why are you, what does having chai at a dhaba or climbing a tree or taking a walk have to do with feminism? And we go back to that idea of first pleasure, you know, the ownership of your time and your space and what you do with it, and then the ability to do it on whim, and then how it's linked to bigger questions of, for example, economic empowerment. So if public space is not open to you the way it is to men, and if you are not feeling safe and you're not mobile, then how do you access those sites of work, right? A big issue that a lot of middle class girls in Pakistan have in the cities is that public transport here is not very women friendly.
It's not very welcoming.
It's not. No, and you know, and then there's like the late night thing. So, I mean, out of necessity, women who belong to a lower class are actually forced into these spaces more, because they have to get to work, so they have to put themselves in these sites. But again, there's the difference between being in a place because of necessity and being in a place because
you want to
be there without any purpose as such. So we started sharing stories of these sort of interactions with the city on our timelines, and then we launched the page May or June 2015, and we asked women and anybody really to send in submissions. So wo bahut saare aane lage, not just like, I mean, the dhaba itself is a site. We'll talk a bit more about chai in a bit. But any kind of, like, you know, place that you're not supposed to be in as a woman or as a trans person or as somebody who is not, whose gender identity is not welcome in that space. And it kind of grew organically from there, with more women joining in the community or sending a message. There were collaborations. So, and one of us was, like, for example, super interested in cricket. So we started hosting street cricket matches. So again, similar sort of interventions of public space, kind of what's against the narrative of what's expected of women. Phir humne ek cycle ride ki thi. A girl was harassed in Lahore while she was on her bicycle. So in response to that, we organized a citywide, like in two cities, we organized a rally on cycles, and a lot of girls came out. That was a lot of fun. You must have heard of Kandil Baloch when she was murdered last year. We, with other organizations, we hosted a bit. So there's really a lot of different things we do, and even though the heart of it is an experience sharing, there's just, we do think that these things are linked, right? You can't talk about public space without also talking about other aspects of gender that then affect how one behaves in public space.
Exactly. I mean, and one more thing, like, you know, the point about middle class girls not being out, it's like this constant dependence on their guy friends or their brothers to take them from one space to another. I mean, through this initiative, a lot of that is changing. A lot of
Well, I won't say like it's changing, like we're not, it's not going to change. Maybe for ourselves and our personal lives.
For our personal lives also, in the sense that they, like, it's like the onus on men to, you know, take care of us has been taken off. So they, like, it's like also empowering to that, you know, just say, okay, I'll come and meet you wherever. And when you suggest a dhaba, they're like, oh, really? And you're like, okay.
And so now Atiya goes on dates at dhabas.
That's what I do.
That's what she's getting at.
It's like basically changed my, also it's a cheap date. So that's a good thing.
The cheap date, yes.
So I think it's like, it changes your relationships with other people as well.
On that, let's talk about the cheap aspect. Okay, so here's another slightly different backstory about, one word we use often is behenchara, which means sisterhood, because there isn't really a word for that in Urdu. So we say, because bhaichara means solidarity, and so one of us came up with behenchara, which is basically, we read that as sisterhood. And a few of us who are on the team of Girls at Dhabas went to this college in the US called Mount Holyoke. It's an all-women's college, some of you might have heard of it. So that college for some reason has a disproportional amount of South Asians, so a lot of Pakistanis and Bangladeshis and Nepalis and Indians. And all of us obviously found each other, and you know, common language was a point of, you know, instant connection. And the college had different cultural centers for different, like the African American kids had a cultural center, the Latina kids had a cultural center. The South Asian kids did not have a cultural center. But there was this other space that was open for, you could basically hang out there, make chai. Aur wahan pe Jumma lunch hota tha. Jumma lunch hota tha, Muslim group karti thi, and a lot of us didn't really care for the prayers. We just went there because sometimes they would have like something like desi food, you know, something like a salan. So in hope of that, we would go towards the end of Jumma lunch and gather there. So all of these South Asians coming because of the food and just the fact that they, you know, that community feeling. And somebody would offer to make chai. This would happen without fail. And then so one person would go to the kitchen and start making a big pot of chai. And people would come and go. Someone's going to class. But that space very organically grew into like a really powerful experience of sisterhood and seeing what can be possible, not just like personally in terms of your sanity, ke healing hoti hai, therapy hoti hai, ek dusre se baat karne se, but you know, politically, because here were women from South Asia who could understand each other's context. And you know, being in a university in America, there's that constant like classroom mein frustration of people not getting your experience, constantly having to explain yourself, not being able to translate something. So here was a community you could rely on where you didn't have all of that baggage and filter. And for the first time in my life, I know I can say this for a few of us, we were surrounded by women in a space where we saw it as a space of possibility and growth for our politics. Okay, we talked about everything, you know, the politics of like parlors to like this Bollywood film, is mein kya problems hai, to meri class, mein, to, like relations, everything. And all of this happening over chai. So I'm coming back to that, I think the dhaba space is really interesting also because it's a true public space in the sense that it's cheap, right? One cup of chai is maybe 20 to 25 rupees here, maybe 30 rupees if you're in a slightly more expensive area. And anybody can afford that, so that means you see all kind of people at a dhaba. The predominant class is middle and lower, but you will see upper class boys, at least, you know, before they make it big, you know, before they graduate to coffee shop, they come here, they have their fun here. And so it's a space where different kinds of people interact, and it's a space that's transient because it's not like a coffee shop or a mall ke table aapne rakhi hai and you can only, you know, sit in a certain place, you have to get up and leave. And it's the interaction with the space is very much who is there, a matter of who is there.
Yeah.
So that is something we think of a lot because our approach is intersectional in that we also want to think about class and we want to think about capitalism and we want to think about, you know, how we don't end up furthering the very idea that we're trying to battle.
There are, I have an interesting story. I've had a number of, you know, upper middle class men say, oh, sometimes when I'm bored, I go out with my friends at a dhaba and we end up like hanging out till like 5 in the morning. And I'm like, yeah, I kind of do that too. And it's sort of like, you know, it's because now that I do, we all hang out at dhabas. So it's like, yeah, we also like to do that and talk to our friends. And again, what she's saying, that it's become this space of community and you know, sharing our
and behenchara, yeah.
So
yeah, so some of our events are, for example, dhaba hop. So we'll invite a bunch of women to come and then we'll go from one dhaba to another, or we have loitering. Some of you might have heard of Why Loiter in India. So there's someone we've collaborated with on and off, depending on when they're having their campaign. And so they use the same idea of, you know, interacting with public space
and erasing the fear and instead like building comfort with the public space. So you learn to navigate it better and you take ownership of it through the lens of loitering, just loitering without a purpose. So unse hamari kafi achhi hai, and they've been way more supportive of us here than a lot of our local feminists in Pakistan. I want to tell you guys a bit about Bangalore. I had the opportunity to visit your lovely city last year in September.
Yeah.
For a poetry slam, and it blew me away. It's a great city and great weather and great people. But what struck me was the visual sort of landscape, because instantly, visually, jo hai na, I saw women everywhere. Compared to Karachi, where if I'm walking, sometimes I count in my head. I'm like, okay, I'm going to count every woman I come across. And it's like for every 20 or 25 men, maybe I'll see one woman. And even she won't be out because she's just there chilling. She'll be out because she's getting somewhere or getting from point A to point B and rushing jaldi jaldi chal rahi hai. In Bangalore, I saw, you know, women on scooties. Over here, we have a horrible culture where ladkiyan bikes pe side pe baithti hain, right? So we never sit like with a few do, but it's really rare to see a woman sitting with her legs apart on a bike because it's considered vulgar. So I was just floored by the amount. I'm like, if they can do it here, why can't we do it at home? But of course, you know, things aren't always what they seem, and just because something is like that on the surface level doesn't mean that things are all great and have really progressed. So I talked to women. I think what I realized was it's the same. The similarity, despite this visual difference and the fact that more women, I did see more women out in Bangalore, there was this still similarity of, you know, the same sort of family rules. A lot of girls I talked to had like strict parents. Yeah, okay, we can go out and we have more liberty in what we wear outside, but then there is the curfew hours, there's the, oh, you were out with boys, there's the, you know, like similar issues, just at a lower intensity, I suppose. But even within public space, like lounging and loitering and just hanging out on the street, the girls, I mean, you guys can tell me more about it. I'd be really curious to know. But the girls I talk to seem to think that it's as, like, obviously it depends on what part of Bangalore you're in. They also said that. But they did say you can't just get up and go anywhere. And, like, it's similar in that aspect of people do look at you and people do get curious, especially if you stand out. So I thought that you'd be interested to hear that. I think we don't want to talk. Do we want to talk more?
I think we covered everything.
We'd like to have some more of a dialogue. I think that'll be interesting. So we're going to have another team member join us, Natasha. She's here, so she'll join us for the Q&A. Something we talk about often is, you know, people say, okay, public spaces, why do you want more women to come out in public spaces? Because isn't it unsafe for them and aren't they under greater threat? And so what we want to say is, statistically, the greatest violence, most physical assault against women occurs in private spaces by people they usually know. And the same is true for men. So the problem really, like, if you want to talk about physical violence, the problem really isn't on the streets. Yes, there are incidents and there is like mob violence of that sort. But if you're talking on daily level, the threat to a woman is much greater when she's at home. And when you use public space as an excuse, then you kind of push her further into...
And the safety isn't the primary issue on the streets. It's respectability, which is what the conversation should be on. You know, guardianship and respectability, which is what we wanted to challenge.
Parting words, parting thoughts. Natasha, what?
Thank you, aapne hamari bakwaas suni.
It was a bakwaas, he says awesome stuff.
No, this is fun for us. And
this
I think that's...
so much fun.
There's also, like, I think, you know, the idea of play and humor, we often miss that in getting caught up in like theoretical jargon and like talking about feminism, and but I think that this affects all of that as well. It's just a different means of talking about the same thing and a more accessible and inclusive means.
Definitely.
Than academic jargon. So I think that will be my parting thought. Thank you though.
Thank
and
you.
Aap log aaye idhar, mile humse.
Yes.
हम आपको घुमाते हैं हमारी ओप्रेसिव स्ट्रीट्स पे अतिया
वेल आई थिंक गाइस लाइक कवर्ड एवरीथिंग
आई थिंक वी टॉक्ड अबाउट इट थैंक यू